What I'd like to do today is share some thoughts with you about the project that I've been working on for quite some time that is related to an earlier book, A Counter History of the Present, and is focused more specifically on a different way of understanding the role of the kind of Western intelligentsia in the global theory industry, and in particular the social, political, and economic stakes of their work. And so I'd like to begin by kind of framing what my understanding of counter history is. I know there's a lot of people working on historical temporality and issues related to this. And then within that framework, introduce some of the work on French theory more specifically, and I'll touch on German critical theory. And then we'll have ample time for discussion, debate, disagreement, etc. Regarding counter history, to begin with, I would say that probably the best way of describing it is in terms of a double gesture of sorts. One gesture consists in identifying the dominant historical imaginary. What I mean by that is the primary way in which common sense tells us that history functions and situates us in relationship to a particular time, a present, and then outlines what is historically possible in the future. And so I think that our historical imaginary, at least the dominant one, is one that tends to tell stories about the progressive march of democracy, the globalization that is linking different communities both technologically and culturally, and also tells a particular narrative about the parameters of cultural, political possibility. And in particular, conjuncturally, it's one of the things that I'm quite preoccupied by. We're told that certain revolutionary agendas on the political front, if it be Marxist, radical anarchist, certain forms of anti-colonial struggle, are now definitively off the table because of a perceived failure of actually existing communism or other such things. And so there's this sense that, well, democracy is the best game in town, and what we could do at best is participate in a kind of reformist agenda of improving it, globalizing it, using technology to further it, etc. And so that's part of the project of counter-history, is dismantling this dominant historical imaginary and dismantling it from the political and social point of view that I would describe as below and from the left. And I'll go into more of that in a second. But the second gesture of counter-history is that I take it that it's insufficient simply to say that there's a historical imaginary that is largely incorrect and that we can develop a different imaginary that would be more appropriate in various ways. But instead, what we need to do is actually reconfigure the very methodological tools that we have for understanding how history operates. And so the second gesture of counter-history is more methodological, but the method or the kind of philosophic elements that go into it are integral to transforming our very understanding of how history operates. And I'll just highlight a few attributes because it'd be important for my comments later on. One is staking out a position of radical historicism that recognizes that all of our concepts, practices, values are historical through and through, meaning that there is no essence to humanity or freedom or equality. There is no static substance that could possibly resist the flow of time. Everything is constituted historically, including the category of Homo sapiens, including planet Earth, including everything that we could try to maintain as being stable and fixed. And the reason that that's important is because if you realize that everything is temporally constituted, then implicit within that is the possibility of remaking what has been made. In addition to radical historicism, one of the things that I've highlighted in my work is the importance of taking seriously three dimensions of history and not just one. By three dimensions, I mean that we have to have an account of chronology, but a chronology that is not simply unidimensional or developmentalist, but recognizes the multidimensionality of temporality, as well as the cultural and historical variability of time itself. So if everything is historical, I would go so far as to say, and a radical historicist would, that time itself is historical. If you know the work of Norbert Elias, of Reinhard Kozelek, of François Hartog, many figures who have worked on this, and I think quite convincingly argued that our understanding of how time works is historically, culturally, economically conditioned, and therefore relative to our immediate context. a multidimensional understanding of temporality then looks at different rival conceptions of time that might be operative within the same conjuncture, and a kind of battle of temporalities of sorts, and does not accept the rather unidimensional, simplistic, and reductivist idea that history is just a kind of temporal line in which there are epochal formations that will change and evolve through the course of time. But this is only one dimension of history. The two others are geography, and I've argued for a kind of radical geography that recognizes that just as in the case of time, our understanding of geography, particularly culturalist and nation-state understandings of geography, are historically specific, they're produced by particular cultures, they don't go without saying, and they're only one conception of space. Right? There are other spaces that are operative well beyond geographic spaces. There are linguistic spaces, technological spaces, cultural spaces. And so just as we need a multidimensional conception of temporality, I've also argued for a multidimensional conception of geography. And then the third dimension is that of sociality. So in each particular space-time, if you kind of identify it at least heuristically, there's a multiplicity of social phenomena that are occurring. And you need an account of that multidimensional aspect of social life so that you don't simply presume that at one time in one place there's only one thing that is occurring. All of this is then to push back against the very widespread idea that there's a kind of zeitgeist that would unify a temporal epoch, or by kind of neologistic extension, a Raumgeist that would unify a particular space. You could say, well, America is this, or Latin America is this, or a Sozialgeist. So you'd simply say, well, all French people today think this. I think that all of these are extremely reductivist, simplistic, and based on poor cartography, because they're not giving us a more complex, materialist account of how history operates. And so the last thing that I would say regarding this kind of counter-historical account is that it's quintessentially multi-agential. History isn't driven by God or by spirit or by a people or by Europe. History is a site of multi-agential conflict in which there's a multiplicity of agents, and agents include individual beings, but they also include collectivities, technologies, economic factors, etc. So bring that all together, and here I'm just kind of very quickly summing up a lot of work that I've been doing for years. I would say that what counter-history does is it dismantles the dominant historical imaginary, not by simply subjecting it to a critique that would say that, well, things are otherwise or different, but instead by dismantling the very conceptual framework that allows it to be produced in the first place. So if there is no zeitgeist, laying claim to the nature of our times and saying our times are X, neoliberal, for instance, or that our times are the times of the digitalization of the world, when less than 50% of the world's population has access to online, regular access to life online. These are reductivist conceptions, right? So it's really a call for a multidimensional account of history that allows us to dismantle both the form and the content of the predominant historical imaginary. This has significant political import, and I'd just like to highlight something that's very topical because it just happened yesterday, and that is that the predominant historical imaginary of the kind of Western world in its globalized extension since World War II, if not earlier, is based on the idea that we live in liberal democracies that uphold the rule of law and whose role is to maintain a neutral state apparatus that protects the rights of all individuals. Right? This is the core of political liberalism. What this account, this historical imaginary, does is it completely effaces other quintessentially important dimensions of history, one of the most important of which is the role of authoritarian and fascistic rule as a quintessential component of all modern liberal nation states. Of course, we saw this perfectly portrayed yesterday with the juxtaposition between the pageantry of the liberal state and its military apparatus, which is performing before the public all of its military might and its kind of pomp and circumstance, presuming that and hoping that all of the citizens would just line up as passive spectators and look at with awe the kind of at once military might and protective state of law of the French nation state combined with the fireworks display and everything else. Well, what's going on at the same time? Well, at the same time, you have Yellow Vest protests that continue to go on, that aren't covered by the media, and the targeting of certain leaders of the Yellow Vest movement who are arrested in very clearly targeted circumstances, taken then to some strange police warehouse holding tank of sorts, all the while with the pageantry going on. And what this displays to me in microcosm is precisely the way liberal nation states have actually functioned historically. And that is, the window display is always one of the state as benefactor protecting the rights of citizens, when what actually occurs is that the poor and anyone who resists the kind of top-down class warfare of the ruling class is subjected systematically to fascistic and authoritarian rule. And so the idea that, well, there's a risk that a nation state would become fascistic, like France or like the United States with all the Trump era, what I would call nonsense, because it's an epical conception of history that misses the fact that, well, fascism and authoritarian rule is integral to how liberal nation states that are capitalistic have always functioned. This is Césaire's point, if you've read the Discourse on Colonialism, concerning the very term fascism, where he says, well, people talk about fascism and all of a sudden it starts happening in Europe, but the history of colonialism is the history of the authoritarian destruction of the lives of masses of the population to subject them to capitalist colonial rule. The problem with a unidimensional history and the dominant historical imaginary is that all of this is effaced, and that all that you can see is either the liberal story of the benefactor nation state, or the contradictions of liberalism, which is, if you think of the work of Chomsky, and there's many others who maintain this line, presume that what the nation state says it could potentially do. Right? So the nation state says that, well, we have the rights of man and of the citizen, we protect all of our citizens, etc. But it's in contradiction because it is constantly doing the opposite. But the problem is that this doesn't understand how the fascism and liberalism actually historically relate to one another. The way they relate is two modes of governance that I refer to as the good cop and the bad cop of capitalist rule. And those two modes of governance function in very close complicity with one another. And they often will toggle back and forth between them. So for poor communities of color in the United States, it's usually fascistic authoritarian rule, the prison industrial complex, etc. But for white, not used just as a color, but as a social category and a social economic category, they're usually subjected to liberal rule. And so if we have a more multidimensional understanding of this history, then we cannot succumb to the idea of some type of, you know, zeitgeist or march of history or other such things. And I think this is integral to a different understanding of how, of our conjuncture. All right? The risk isn't that fascism will come about. The reality is that it's always already been here. And that liberals, in particular, have to be able to train themselves to see its existence. I touched on this very briefly last time, and I'd be thrilled to talk more about it because it's related to a lot of my contemporary research. But the whole narrative that's been shoved down everybody's throat through Hollywood and soft power mechanisms in general is fundamentally flawed. The idea that the United States defeated Nazism and fascism and then established the liberal rule of law and extended it around the world is flawed at so many levels I wouldn't even know where to begin. I mentioned Operation Paperclip, where 1,600 Nazis were brought directly into the United States after the war, given laboratories and funding for the research. 10 to 15,000, according to Eric Lichtblau's study, Nazis were brought in after the war. The goal was to maintain what the U.S. knew very clearly, because we have all of these internal documents that spell it out, and that is that the fascists and the Nazis are very good at one thing, and that is destroying anybody who tries to resist capitalism. And so we've got to work with these hired guns and set up, people know Operation Gladio within Europe. They set up secret stay-behind armies that have been extremely well documented. These documents go up to the European Union has a resolution on it, so it's not like some weirdo conspiracy theory, as well as the Italian courts, because it went up to the high courts in Italy, and the state of Italy was found guilty of having a stay-behind army, which was orchestrated by the CIA, which was a group of fascists whose role was to make sure that if leftists came anywhere close to power, their organizations would be destroyed, their leaders would be targeted for assassination or for incarceration. And they began, during the strategy of tension, then committing acts of terrorism against the civilian population in order to do two things. One is to scare the lights out of the citizenry, to make sure that they would then vote in law and order governments, which were right-wing governments. And secondly, to delegitimate leftist movements, particularly the communists, but anyone who is anti-capitalist, anarchists, etc. And that project is precisely how the world that we live in functions, but it's just difficult for people to see. This is why, conceptually, I refer to this as the aesthetics of power. The aesthetics of power indexes how powerful apparatus, like a nation state or the global corporatocracy, produces an image of itself, an aesthetics of itself, that is quintessential to the functioning of that power. So if the US, if people educated in the US, for instance, knew about anything from the Japanese internment camps to Operation Gladio to a whole series of other operations that were going on, then it would be much more difficult to keep the citizenry, you know, placated. And so you have to produce an image of power that is more or less the opposite of how that power actually functions. And that's why soft power is so important. It really confuses people about how the world actually works. And so I'd like to relate this then to, these are the kind of macro issues, but then I've become more and more interested more specifically on the role of the intelligentsia in this broader kind of counter-historical account of the current conjuncture. And I'd like to bring in a few elements in this regard. Very quickly, the way in which the history of French theory is usually told, of course, is that, well, there was this period in the post-war era when a group of existentialist phenomenologists, Sartre in particular, but then also Beauvoir and a few others, were invested in a kind of individualist philosophy of freedom. And that on the heels of this, structuralism developed in the 1960s and 1970s that revealed how naive existentialism was because it believed in the freedom, it believed in freedom, it believed in the human subject, etc. And so then structuralism introduced a kind of scientific account of social relations, and it was driven by the social sciences, that called into question the very existence of the subject, highlighted the ways in which the subject is actually constituted by social forces, etc. And then post-structuralism, which is, historically speaking, it's an Anglophone invention, but tempted to identify certain later structuralists as breaking with the idea that structures could be closed and instead identifying them as infinitely open to interpretation, etc. And so what you have is a kind of movement model of history that's epically configured and progressive. Right? The existentialists were naive, the structuralists were more sophisticated, the post-structuralists were really, really sophisticated. Now, there's a million things that are left out of this standard narrative regarding French theory. I'll just highlight a few of them very quickly. One is that the existentialists were all communists, and they had a political project. And that political project was anti-capitalist and anti-imperialist. And quite resolutely so, at least at one point in time in the post-war, particularly in the post-war era. That was completely bracketed from the American reception of Sartre and company in order to read them as kind of navel-gazing individualists and whatnot. And then the structuralists emerge at a moment in time where there's a reconfiguration institutionally of the dominant institutions of higher learning within France. And largely comes out of a number of philosophers who became invested in the social sciences in various ways. So you have Bourdieu, who was trained as a philosopher, who became a sociologist. You have Foucault, who was trained as a philosopher, who became a historian. You have Althusser, who of course was trained as a philosopher and largely remained one, but then also became very invested in political science in various ways. And so there's this investment in the social sciences that destabilizes certain operative understandings of what philosophy is, but is also premised on the rejection of the dominant philosophy of the preceding era, which was Marxism. So the majority of structuralists, with few exceptions, if you follow out their trajectory, they flirt with Marxism early on and then tend to either take a lot of distance from it or become rabidly critical of it in various ways. With the exception, the very important exception of Althusser and some of the Althusserians. And of course we could get into the details of what exactly, how exactly that functioned. And this is important for their Anglophone reception, which I'll get to in a moment, but the post-structuralists then are taken as this kind of uber-sophisticated critique of structuralism, when in many ways, particularly as it's instantiated within the work of Derrida, this is a return to philosophic order. One of the things that Derrida chastised the structuralists for was moving away from philosophy proper. What does philosophy proper do? It analyzes the canonical texts of the Western tradition through an internal mode of analysis and points out its paradoxes and contradictions. The structuralists, though, were engaging in material history and in economics and in all of these scary things that were diluting the purity of the philosophic enterprise. And so Derrida in particular, but some of the other post-structuralists as well, I think historically need to be read in terms of a philosophic call of a return to order, and they actually remain very conservative in their theoretical practices, in spite of the rhetorical gestures to the contrary, and their politics are usually so far alienated from Marxism that they almost don't even need to reject it, because it goes without saying. I mean, there are exceptions, of course, here, because Deleuze maintained a certain proximity to particular forms of Marxism, and it's very influenced by the work of Guattari and the political engagements of Guattari. Derrida had his, you know, rhetorical engagements with specters of Marx, and we could say a lot more about that, but I think that we have to be attentive to how the Anglophone reception of French theory has formatted its interpretation in various ways, and it's formatted them in such ways that largely bracket and cut out the political stakes of what was actually going on in France. One of the documents here that I shared with you is just a interesting formulation on the part of the Central Intelligence Agency, which was very invested in soft power and its relationship to American imperial hegemony in, well, from the Second World War to the present. One of the things that they highlight in the highlighted passage here is that although both structuralism and Annales methodology have fallen on hard times, we believe their critical demolition of Marxist influence in the social sciences is likely to endure as a profound contribution to modern scholarship both in France and elsewhere in Western Europe. So the CIA recognized this, right? That the structuralist and the Annales school, if you're familiar with the Annales school of historiography, contributed to the demolition of Marxism, and that's one of the reasons that they financially supported the structuralist movement, both through their own work and through the network of foundations that they worked very closely with, particularly the Ford Foundation and the Rockefeller Foundation. The Ford Foundation, of course, funded the grand arrival in 1966 of French theory in the United States by subjecting it to the transatlantic filter, where they invited all of the structuralists who weren't Marxists and rejected all of the structuralists who were Marxists, in part because they were personas non grata within the United States. With this in mind, then, one of the other things that is important to highlight in this regard in developing a kind of counter-history of French theory is that it's often presumed that this French theory of the kind of structuralist and post-structuralist vein brought with it some type of political force that was radical. And usually this is done through an analogy with the movement of May 68. Right? This is how they've been marketed, if you will, is the thinkers of 68. There's the famous book Baronneau and Ferry on this topic, but there's a ton of other literature that presumes an analogy that is purely mythological between the structuralists and post-structuralists and the revolutionary uprising of May 68. I could go through the examples. I mean, I already mentioned Foucault. Derrida, of course, participated in a very limited and circumspect manner in the movement of 68 by organizing one event at the ONS, walking through the streets with, I believe, Eugenie at one point in time, and then immediately withdrawing to the countryside, to his parents' house to write, and was insistent in two later interviews that he wasn't a 68er, that it wasn't his cup of tea, that 68 was naive because it believed in the power of discourse and the transparency of language and things along these lines. Bourdieu said as much as well, that he wasn't a 68er. He kept his research lab open during 68. Of course, his research lab that he was running at this institution was directed by Raymond Aron. Aron is the anti-68er par excellence, a right-wing... he was good friends with Kissinger and received an unbelievable amount of support from the Central Intelligence Agency for the translation of his books, for his publications, and for his collaboration with the Congress for Cultural Freedom, which was a CIA front organization that was run in some 35 countries around the world, but was had its center and its head in Paris. And Raymond Aron was the philosopher of the Congress for Cultural Freedom in many ways. We could go on with the list. Lévi-Strauss and Barthes very quickly left Paris in order to, you know, get away from the rabble and the students. And those who actually were involved either in the movements leading up to 68 or 68 itself or into the radical theorizing that came out of 68, people like Sartre, Castoriadis, Claude Dufour, Henri Lefebvre, are all of those people who, lo and behold, weren't incorporated into the corpus of French theory. They were left by the wayside as secondary figures or as less important for some reasons. This is what has led me to believe, and I'm currently working on a paper on this topic, that the analogy between French theory and 68 is the result of a historical commodity fetishism. What historical commodity fetishism does is it masks the actual social relations operative in a conjuncture, right, behind the enchantment with a particular product, like French theory, of the global intellectual industry. Right? So just as commodity fetishism will mask the social relations. If you're fetishized by a commodity like a computer, you don't see the extraction of resources, the labor relations, the advertising industry, and everything that goes into producing this computer. You just lose sight of all of those social relations in the name of the object itself. And that's in many ways exactly what's happened with 68. The material social relations have been completely lost in the name of the symbolic power of the kind of enchanting emblem of 68, which has then been used to market a particular group of thinkers that had little or nothing to do with that movement or were radically opposed to it in various ways. It's with this in mind, then, that counter-history has a very significant engagement with the work of someone like Foucault, and I'd like to return to this briefly. I've touched on some aspects of Foucault's work. One thing that I'd really like to insist on is that often when people do material history, there's the presumption that they're not doing philosophy or that they don't have knowledge of particular philosophic corpus, because usually academics are one-trick ponies, right? You can do one thing, like maybe one discipline and probably not that well. So the idea that you could do a material history but then also really understand the entire corpus of individual thinkers, usually it doesn't happen. And then secondly, the presumption is that if someone like myself, for instance, is doing this kind of macro view, then there must not be a deep knowledge of what was actually going on in the texts themselves. And so if you bear with me, I would like to highlight a few things in Foucault that I think are particularly important for both the proximity and distance from counter-history. In particular, his conceptualization of genealogy. Because genealogy, in many ways, there is a certain proximity to what I'm interested in counter-history, and that is there is a radical historicism injected in certain forms of genealogy. Right? When Foucault claims that there's no madness in general, there's only madness in the classical age, in the Renaissance classical age, and the modern age. This is a radical historicist claim. Right? There's no essence behind history, there's no trans-historical substances, etc. But so there's also some overlap on certain aspects of historical methodology. Foucault, in The Order of Things, for instance, really insists on there being different strata of history. there is some geographic complexity, at least in the trinity that he focuses on, which is England, Germany, and France. But there's no broader account of radical geography, of the colonial situation, of the extra-European world, with few exceptions, like his very poor engagement with what was going on in Iran and other such things. And genealogy comes out of the Nietzschean heritage. And as trendy and radical as Nietzsche is, and as powerful of a thinker, because I really think he's a force to be grappled with, we have to remember that he was rabidly he was anti-democracy, he was anti-socialist, he was obviously anti-communist. He was a defender of the noble race and its superiority over the slave race. And this is the lineage that Foucault draws on to develop this project. And so it's not surprising at all that Foucault, much like Rancière, who's described his own project as a genealogy of aesthetics, is extremely critical of revolutionary projects that attempt to change the social fabric, and followed an intellectual trajectory that's very similar to that of the new philosophers. Right? In fact, his fallout with Deleuze was around the work of André Glucksmann. If you know the new philosophers, a number of them were affiliated with the Maoist movements in 68, and then very quickly moved to the right in the post-68 years, and their main focus was on anti-totalitarianism, so a critique of the Soviet Union. And they had no critique of American imperialism, of other forms of colonialism. They really just focused on the Soviet Union and then highlighted the political dissidents from the Soviet Union as breaking with the totalitarian rule, etc. And they were rabidly, rabidly anti-Marxist and completely blind to history, because they made the equation that Stalin equals Hitler, even though they just fought a world war against one another in which Stalin won against Hitler. So it makes no sense, that type of amalgam, as you'd say in France. And this is the trajectory that Foucault follows, and it's the debate that he has with Deleuze, is that Deleuze doesn't support the new philosophers. He thinks they're a complete sham and just media philosophers who are promoted by the general corporatocracy and rabidly anti-Marxist. But Foucault defends Glucksmann, writes a very laudatory book review, and actually uses some of his own symbolic capital as a prominent intellectual to promote the work of Glucksmann in particular, and he has very laudatory things to say about François Furet. In this regard, I mean, I have a few quotes, but I can jump over this quickly. This is more about the Foucault's stance on radical social change. You see this very clearly in a lot of the later texts, where he wants to make sure that any global and radical project is dangerous because it will lead to the replication of what he calls the most dangerous traditions. And of course, what he has in mind here is anything that has anything to do with communism. And he, in addition to his critiques of the women and gay liberation movements, is comes to the one of his conclusions. And of course, I mean, Foucault's a chameleon, right? He's constantly redefining what it is that he's doing. He's invested in a process of autofiction that's important for understanding his work. But he does make some very clear statements that I think ring true to parts of his corpus, such as the following: true liberation means knowing oneself. La véritable libération signifie se connaître soi-même. Right? Which is very, very close to one of Rancière's proclamations, and his description, I highlighted this before, of Gabriel Goni, the planer, who like looks out the window for a second, and that's his emancipation, and then he just goes back to work. This type of individualist investment in liberation being something that happens within the mind by an isolated subject that's not contesting social norms and not collectively organizing, I think really shows part of the political center of gravity of Foucault's work, and his investment in a kind of morality, more so than in the Nietzschean sense, more so than in a politics. And again, he said this himself. He said, "I would more or less agree with the idea that in fact what interests me is much more morals than politics, or in any case, politics as an ethics." Right? He's very explicit about it in a lot of the later work. Now, I have a whole section on Derrida, in part as well because these thinkers have been very important to my own intellectual evolution, and I don't want to give the impression at all that anything that I say is somehow flippant or off the cuff, and that I haven't worked through for over decades their body of work. But I might just keep that for the discussion in the name of getting into some of the meat of things that I'd like to have on the board for discussion. One of them is the role that the CIA identified Foucault as playing. And I think it's an important formulation, right? The CIA in 1980, this is a document from 1985, says, "The New Right can point to kudos for Michel Foucault, France's most profound and influential thinker. Foucault has praised the upstarts for, among other things, reminding philosophy of the bloody consequences that have flowed from the rationalist social theory of the 18th century Enlightenment and the Revolutionary Era." And what they're pointing to is Foucault's defense of the new philosophers, who were in the same document. At the end of this document, there's a great annotated bibliography of the new philosophers that the CIA provides, basically saying, hey, these are the people who are doing our work in France. Isn't it great that the most prominent French philosopher at this point in time is supporting their work? So one of the reasons that this is important is not at all to have a kind of facile reading that's consistent saying that, oh, you know, everything that Foucault did or thought was just produced by the CIA, or they just recuperated him. Or, you know, I think what's important is to identify what they saw, and I think they were right in seeing this, is the social function his discourse played in post-war French theory and in its development into the global theory industry through the United States. And this is a heritage that we really have to not only think seriously about, but also come to terms with. And so I'd like to give you a little bit of insight into how I think this world works and why I think this is important, because of course when you bring up CIA documents or reference organizations of this sort, often people have, and it's indicative of how history works, because you know, James Bond comes to mind, or all of a whole set of stereotypes of these nefarious figures who are meeting in smoky rooms and have briefcases full of cash and are killing people with silencers and whatnot. And of course that goes on, you know, it went on and still goes on. But one of the problems with how soft power operates is a fundamental lack of understanding of its internal mode of operation. So most people think, oh, it's a conspiracy theory, or they were taking advantage of, or they were doing this, that, and the other thing. And what I'd like to highlight is, and I'll come back to some of the vocabulary I used earlier, and that is understanding knowledge production in terms of a cultural apparatus of knowledge. What I mean by that is the whole system within which knowledge is produced, how it's circulated in the social world, and how it's received by a particular public. All three of these dimensions are part of this apparatus of knowledge. So it's not just universities, it's the system of the press, it's all of the material relations that make it such that particular forms of knowledge are produced and therefore others aren't. Some are promoted and become highly visible, others are not. And that what the CIA has been historically interested in doing is understanding this apparatus of knowledge and developing it in such a way that it furthers its own particular agenda. So one of the metaphors that I've often used is that people, the stereotypical version of the CIA is the kind of marionette version. You presume that intellectuals would be there and as marionettes, and the CIA would be hidden up there and they'd be pulling strings, and the, you know, little marionette intellectual would be writing things out. That it doesn't happen that way. How it happens is that the CIA is an enormous corporate entity that buys, literally, marionette theaters, and then the marionettes come. And the marionettes come, and they do the work that needs to be done within that marionette theater that then becomes famous within that marionette theater. So it's a structural and institutional mode of intervention, which is much less precarious, much more difficult to detect, and much more powerful than the precarious one-to-one individualist relationship between an officer and an agent on the ground, for instance. A little bit of history might be helpful in this regard. The CIA, of course, emerged out of the OSS, which was the predecessor organization. It was the wartime intelligence service in the United States. And the OSS was the brainchild of the millionaire Wall Street lawyer William Wild Bill Donovan, as he was called. And it was stocked with Ivy League professors who were brought to Washington. So one of the best ways of understanding how the CIA operates is recognizing that it is the result of the military-industrial academic complex. What I mean by that is that there are three poles of power that basically collaborate. The Ivy League institutions and elite institutions are absolutely quintessential to the entire history of the CIA. The Wall Street, and particularly Wall Street financial interests and the lawyers on Wall Street, and then of course Washington. So you have the corporate sector and then you have the governmental sector. The OSS, the exact number of researchers, they had the largest research institute in the first half of the 20th century was run by the OSS. And the numbers vary on this, anywhere from 1,000 to 2,000, depending on the particular source. Raphael Lodowney has argued that it was the research center, it was not only the biggest research center in the first half of the 20th century in the United States, but it then set the agenda for post-war American social sciences. Because the people they recruited were the top people in their fields, who then went out and became the heads of the American Historical Association, the heads of the American Psychological Association, the directors of the American Philosophical Association, etc. So the elite power center of the academic world, because the way the OSS and the CIA function is that they have two branches that function in close complicity to one another, research and analysis, and the kind of death arm, which is the one that people usually know more about, all the coup d'etat, etc. And research and analysis is what university professors do, right? And so the idea was to recruit the best and the brightest to a wartime effort, and then the CIA was modeled directly on the OSS. You know, I mentioned this, I think, in passing, but five members of the Frankfurt School were working for the deep state in the United States, including Marcuse, Neumann. Neumann, who was a double agent, was actually working for the KGB at the same time, which is kind of fascinating micro-history within all of this. And there's a possibility in the KGB archives I've gone through, and they were interested in potentially recruiting Marcuse. It's unclear whether or not they reached out and made contact with him. But Marcuse must have known that Neumann was working for the KGB because he was so tight with the Neumanns that when his wife, Marcuse's wife, died, he moved in with the Neumanns. And when Neumann died in a car crash, he married Neumann's wife. So if anyone was in like deep intimacy of the world of Neumann quad double agent, it was Marcuse. That is not an anomaly, though. They wanted, the OSS, like the CIA, wanted the best and the brightest working for them, and they had the financial clout to do that. The history of the CIA, then, as it develops out of the OSS, starting in 1947, were the activities that they were involved in were virtually unlimited, particularly in the post-war era, where the fundamental agenda was to destroy the most dangerous idea known to the capitalist ruling class, and that was the idea of communism. And so one of the ways I describe the project that I'm currently working on is that you probably all know the well-known kind of leftist slogan that, particularly when somebody who's a militant on the left dies, people say, well, you can kill a person, but you can't kill an idea. My research is focusing on the organization that wanted to kill an idea, the idea of socioeconomic equality, so that you could kill a lot more people. Because if you kill that idea, then you destroy the possibility of breaking with capitalist rule. And their investment was quasi-infinite. They had basically an unlimited budget, in part through their involvement with the international criminal economy, which is enormous, drug trafficking, sex trafficking, organ trafficking, things like this. But as well because their budget's undisclosed to Congress. And so we don't actually know how much money is being funneled in. But they took control of unions, political parties, civic organizations, church groups, student associations, feminist organizations, African American groups. The list goes on and on and on. And it goes very, very deep. The National Student Association in the United States was basically run by a small handful of CIA-funded figures who just took over the leadership of the entire organization. Gloria Steinem is, of course, the famous case. I recommend that you all YouTube her statement saying that the CIA is not all everybody thinks it is. They're actually really nice guys. They're invested in the rule of law, etc., because she worked for a CIA front organization. And there are many other intellectuals who are caught up in this. Hannah Arendt's another very interesting case. The organization that I mentioned a moment ago, the Congress for Cultural Freedom, U. Wilford, who has published an important book with Harvard UP, described it as one of the largest patrons of art and culture in the history of the world. It was established in 1950. It worked, Raymond Aron and Hannah Arendt worked closely with the Congress for Cultural Freedom. It hated the work of Sartre, de Beauvoir, and Fanon. These were the enemies and the people to be destroyed, and they ran endless smear campaigns against it. At its peak, the Congress for Cultural Freedom had offices in 35 countries, mobilized an army of about 280 employees, published more than 20 prestigious journals, held international seminars, organized numerous art and cultural exhibitions, as well as international concerts and festivals. During its lifetime, it also organized 37 conferences, and these conferences weren't small affairs. They were conferences with literally thousands of people in attendance, simultaneous translation into four or five languages, usually then followed up by publications and press coverage in the major press. All right, so it was by no means a small affair. They published at least 170 books, and they also had a press service called Forum Press, which broadcast free of charge all over the world the reports from its intellectuals, and it reached about 600 newspapers and had a readership of about 5 million. This is what Josselson, the CIA agent in France, who was very good friends with Raymond Aron and was regularly mingled with the French intelligentsia, referred to as our big family. And others refer to it as the great Wurlitzer, the idea being that the CIA could have any intellectual story that it wanted played on its international jukebox just by getting Josselson to spread the word through all of their subsidiaries. This is related to the broader control of the press globally. The director of the New York Times, Arthur Hayes Salzberger, was a close personal friend of Alan Dulles, and he signed a confidentiality agreement with the CIA, which is the highest form of collaboration with the CIA. William Paley's CBS was CIA's greatest asset in the field of audiovisual broadcasting. They actually had a direct phone line that didn't go through their operator that they put into the CIA so they could immediately call them without the other people working in the office actually knowing it. Henry Luce's Time Incorporated, which ran, of course, Time, Life, Fortune, Sports Illustrated, had very, very close ties with all of the top brass of the CIA. I could go on. One of the reasons that this is this network is important is because the way in which the Congress for Cultural Freedom and the CIA operated was to produce a global institutional matrix that facilitated the promotion of anti-Marxist work and anti-anarchist, anything that was against hard left positions. And the protocol within the CIA is that what they wanted to support was what they called the either the non-communist left or the compatible left. And the compatible left, of course, was the liberal left that was fine with capitalist rule. I've mentioned this already, so I'll go over this very quickly. The very institution that we're within was supported by the Ford Foundation, enormous grant from the Ford Foundation, and later by the Rockefeller Foundation. If you look at the leaders of the Ford Foundation, you trace out their history almost without exception goes back to the OSS, the CIA, and the deep state in various ways. Nelson Rockefeller, of course, ran the equivalent of the OSS for Latin America during the Second World War. David Rockefeller was a spy in France. First he worked in North Africa in order to destabilize the anti-colonial movements, and then worked as a spy in France. So the idea that there'd be kind of the corporations over here and the deep state over here is a fundamentally flawed idea of how these institutions and these power mechanisms function. And so the fact that the Ford Foundation would then fund the great arrival of French theory in the United States, and that French theory as a kind of product would be packaged in such a way that it's the compatible left of French theory that gets promoted over and against the anti-imperialist left, I think illustrates the power of this kind of institutional matrix. There are a few, I might just, in the kind of interest of wrapping up and then opening up for a general discussion, these are just a few documents that I threw in so you could see the kind of nature of this reach. This is just highlighting, I kind of went over this quickly, but the work of Marcuse as the acting chief of the Central European branch of the OSS. Marcuse, of course, said in interviews that he had no connection whatsoever to the CIA, but this statement here clearly says that the OSS then, or the work that he was doing at this point in time, had links to the Central Intelligence Agency, as you can see right here. Otto Kirchheimer, who was also a member of the Frankfurt School, was also part of this same organization at that point in time. This is just, you know, it's great that the CIA also has photographs of Foucault and some of their internal documents pointing out what an asset he was. Again, I'm just kind of burning through things, but to show you that there's some important archival work that's behind this. This is a famous statement made by Thomas Braden, who I highly recommend. You can find this online. It's a short PDF. He says, "I'm glad the CIA is immoral," and Braden was involved in setting up a lot of the soft power organizations within Europe to fight against the communist intelligentsia, and he goes through in details a lot of what it is that they did, and so it's an internal account of it. It's presumable, though, the history of the CIA is one in which there are always different levels that are hidden. I think that this is what's called a limited hangout, meaning that there was so much flack around CIA involvement when it was discovered that the Congress for Cultural Freedom was a CIA front organization and people like Arendt and others were involved in it. One of the things that the CIA does to control that is to admit the tip of the iceberg so that they can distract people from the larger set of issues that's going on. Braden wrote this with Stuart Alsop, who is, I think it was Stuart, or is his brother, Joseph Alsop, who was a CIA asset, who was a journalist, and it was published in a CIA newspaper, and the CIA vetted this article before it was published, and so it's clear that it was part of probably a larger orchestration of relations. But I think I'll end, and I'm kind of just burning through things very, very quickly because I want to be cognizant of time. I'll just end with this document from the Church Committee, which I think is important, just to give you a sense of, because one of the other claims that's sometimes been made is, well, this is just, you know, a few intellectuals, a little bit of a dragnet, things that emerged at one point in time, but now it's all behind us or it's all part of the past. The Church Committee was set up in order to investigate when there were a whole series of revelations around what the CIA was doing, both the kind of death arm and the research and analysis branch. The Church Committee was set up, like a lot of other committees, by the U.S. government as, you know, it's extremely limited in what they actually did. So there's a section that I would encourage you to read that's on academics and journalists. One of the things that they say here in the highlighted passage is that altogether, DCD and FRD, which are these two, it's the Foreign Resources Division and the Domestic Collection Division, which are part of the CIA, are currently in contact, ranging from the occasional debriefing to a continuing operational relationship with many thousands of United States academics at hundreds of US academic institutions. Right, so many thousands of academics, and this is according to an admission that itself was vetted by the CIA and rewritten by the CIA in order to be, in a rushed fashion, published in the Church Committee documents, because this was discovered at the last second of the committee, and one of the things that the committee decided is that the degree of intervention on the part of the CIA into the world of journalism and the academy was so extensive that it would require an entire another commission and investigation in order to get to the bottom of it. And of course the CIA tried to shut all of this down, and the person who wrote these words was a member of the CIA. So what you have is a very, very limited account, but at least an internal admission that points to the kind of depth of this involvement. And the overall question really that this leaves for me is that if we're interested in something like critical theory or the relationship between theoretical labor and a practical transformation of a social world, then we need much better accounts of this apparatus of knowledge and how it produces particular subjects of knowledge production, valorizes specific types of discourse, promotes particular worldviews, and of course forecloses or destroys other such ones. Because if we don't have that account, then I think we're put in a situation where at best we might have, you know, some individual coming up with some new theory that probably won't get a lot of traction unless it's promoted in particular ways, and we don't have a broader understanding of how knowledge production, circulation, and reception actually functions in our own material conjuncture. So I'll wrap up there, and then we can open up for questions, comments, criticisms, debate. Wayne, you want to get us started?
Sure. in the spirit of radical politics, can I give you a radical criticism?
Yeah.
I have a problem with your radical historicism.
Okay.
And my critique would be to say that you are a historical idealist.
How?
Because I want to begin by asking you what your counter-historiography would say about something like Nazism. Would it say that it's progressive or regressive?
Neither.
Neither. What would it say?
It would say that the presumption of either progress or regress, as they're at least classically understood,
right,
is in terms of a unidimensional understanding of history where you can say, well, time A is worse and time B is better. And a multidimensional history looks at all of the different factors that are operative. And so then the valuative judgment isn't evacuated, like, oh, we can't judge it all. Instead, it would consist in saying that, well, there are certain dimensions that would be better and certain dimensions that are worse.
So
depending
that's, I think,
on
my problem, I think, is that in that commitment, the idea, you claimed earlier as well in your background of radical historicism that you said something like temporality is itself historically constant.
Yeah.
Right? So these values, is what you're saying, are also things which are
absolutely
up, right, obviously.
Yeah.
But then that's precisely the problem, though, isn't it? Is that your notion of reality itself is something which is historically determined, and thus, I would say, idealistic on that basis.
Idealistic in how
it's
do you understand idealism?
Because there's no such thing as something that's outside of history, according to your account. Thus, we can have something like a hegemonic history. Like you began your remarks with the idea that there's this sort of hegemonic story of liberalism, for example, right?
Yeah.
And the project of a counter history is to develop a counter imaginary, because that can provide us with counter conditions of futures,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And I'm on board with all that. That's all great. But if you don't have something that's outside of that framework, what makes a counter-historiography more substantive than a hegemonic one?
Yeah.
And that's my beef, right?
Yeah.
That's what I think makes you an idealist with your commitment to radical historicism.
Okay, I don't see, I completely understand the first part of the question. I don't see the link to idealism, because the way I understand idealism is the presumption that there is some type of essence that
right
is outside of history and could be our kind of skyhook that we could attach values to.
Love it, right. So I think that's, well, I'm equivocating that. So yeah, I totally hear that. What I mean by idealist is something like your notion of reality, for example,
mm-hmm,
is something which is imaginary.
It's something
what you
imagined?
Would call reality is something that's historically determined in a post-structuralist sort of sense.
Let me take a shot at it and see if this responds to it. Because I hear two things in what you're saying. One is a question of reality and the other is a question of values.
Sure.
Both of these are, in my vocabulary, I wouldn't say historically determined, because I don't think that we can reduce the totality of reality or values to some foundational structure that would define all of them. Instead, they're conditioned by a conjuncture of determinants. But that if we take values to start with, and I think it's a really important question, because it's often one that's raised, particularly in settings where someone's interested in social transformation. You say, well, in the name of what, why would this social organization be better than that one?
Right.
What the position of radical historicism for me says is that, yeah, values are historical through and through. What this means is that they've been historically constituted out of struggle, and that all values are values in struggle. And that the presumption that I hear behind your question is that we need some type of universal value that we could relate to in order to say that this is better than this. We've actually never needed that. You don't
think this is what's actually maybe like when you position that as your counterpoint, I think that's where your account maybe goes a little astray, because there are other accounts to history. Rahel Yegi's account, for example, which is a pragmatist account, which doesn't rely on a universalism, which is actually non-teleological in any way. Her social ontology is predicated, of course, on the idea that social practices are problem-solving entities,
mm-hmm,
and ones which are better than others are ones which are not as dysfunctional as others, right? And so this is an account, this is a social ontology which unpacks her entire notion of history, which gives us a materialist, pragmatist account which we can use to tell, say certain things are progressive and regressive without the appeal to universalism. My hesitance with your counter-history is that when you position your opponent as this Hegelian universalist, you at the same time obfuscate other sorts of materialist versions of history which can provide us with a very good account of progress and regress, which allows us to say things like National Socialism is regressive. My main criticism, just to crystallize my point, is that your counter-historiography doesn't allow us to call such things as regressive when we should be able to say as much.
Yeah, let me clarify then, because for me, and values, the fact that values are historically and socially constituted doesn't mean that then one can either not judge them, or one can't say that, well, in relationship to Nazism, for instance, and I think that you actually have to have a really multidimensional analysis of this. There are certain dimensions of history where you'd say, yeah, the Nazi death camps are, we can judge that and say, yeah, that's bad. But saying that that's bad, you do not need any universal value. And so the kind of more pragmatist, immanent conception of values as socially constituted out of struggle is precisely the position that I'm outlining. That position doesn't have to then say that everything
is historically determined for you, right? What's struggle?
Every concept that we have is a concept in struggle. But here, let me explain in terms of a distinction that I've used in some of my other work, and that is the difference between transcendent concepts are precisely what we both don't want to have, right? We get rid of the idea that there's equality itself or freedom or something like that. But there are also immanent concepts and interventionist concepts. By an immanent concept, I mean one, and or an immanent value. I'd say the exact same thing about values. Immanent values are ones that particular communities in specific conjunctures have developed in order to regulate their communities, such as the value of equality as it's understood within the Marxist tradition. Right? That is something that, from the point of view of someone like myself, I can intervene in that and say, those are values that I want to push forward and I will struggle for those values. That doesn't require anything transcendent, but it also doesn't mean that there's some type of wishy-washy relativism in which everything is just lost in this endless chaos. Right? And so it's immanent values. What, from my point of view, an axiology really needs is an account of the immanent values of a particular conjuncture, while at the same time the recognition that we're the vehicles, or partial vehicles, because many other forces are also vehicles for those values. And the choice is then between what types of values we want to push forward and mobilize, and what ones we want to push back against. But there's no guarantee, there's nothing transcendent. So I think, I mean, from what I hear from you, what you're arguing for is an immanent conception of value formation that's not purely relativist. And if that's the case, that's what I'm arguing for. On the idealist front, the reason that counter-history for me is anti-idealist is precisely because any of these transcendent concepts, values, etc., what they really are, if you unpack them, and I've done this in some of my work, is they're faux transcendentals. Because any universal that's postulated, such as equality or freedom, etc., what you actually do is you take an immanent value and you hypostatize it by making it into a universal. Now, you might want to do that in certain instances for strategic or rhetorical purposes. But as far as its description of reality, it is completely inadequate. Right? And then the last thing that I'd say about the status of reality is that, yeah, reality is, like, what is real is absolutely at once imminently constituted and then the result of multiple interventions into an not just arguments, but also fights over what constitutes reality. And so the fact that that values would be in struggle is basically a way of reconceptualizing their relationship, so you get rid of universal transcendent appeals, but you also reject the idea that that makes everything relative or into this like soup of nonsense. It's instead recognizing, and this is the tradition, I mean, there are of course many people that I'm drawing on in this regard, certain forms of pragmatism, certain forms of French epistemology, the immanent conceptualization of norms that you get in people like Canguilhem, that you get in people like Foucault. There's a lot of different traditions that I'm calling from in this regard. But I do think it's important for avoiding at once idealism, but then also the presumption that all values are gone if you don't have some type of transcendental skyhook that you can latch onto.
So what makes a counter-history more real than a hegemonic one is that we're willing to struggle for it.
I wouldn't formulate it exactly that way, but I think that history is forged out of a multiplicity of agencies, and that reality is not an absolute given. The reality that we have constituted for us, like very simple things like the earth is round, etc., It's the result of historical struggles that, and this actually this might help because it's another dimension to this account of immanent values and concepts, is that you need an account of historical sedimentation. And historical sedimentation is the process by which certain struggles have been won in the past, they sediment over time, and they establish kind of kernels of reality. And so now the idea that the Earth is round, most or almost round, most people would generally accept. But that's just the result of sedimentation, right? So it's not as if everything is in struggle and in flux in the same way. Certain things are much more open to struggle than others. And that also relates to how hegemonic particular discourses are, is how open they actually are to struggle. The great analyses of the ways in which a certain discourse and political mobilization around the category of equality in the 19th century really introduced a field of struggle that broke with the presumption that societies were naturally organized in relationship to different social categories that were purely naturalized, right? And I think that's another important dimension. It's the kind of historicity of immanent values, right? Because values also have their own historicity, but those historicities can be quite different. Other questions, criticisms, comments? Ralph?
Okay, so I'm all in on the multi-agential, anti-essentialist approach. I think it seems to me that it's not consistent with the Marxist, the way you use the term materialist view, where that is, and seems to have, at least for centuries, always been the primary cause. So that seems to me to be a problem. I would put it, so, from my view of a multi-agential approach, seems to me that capitalism and fascism can be two totally separate regimes of power that sometimes find a way to work together and sometimes fight amongst each other. And so I agree with your good cop, bad cop analysis, but that works with seeing them as separate rather than seeing fascism as internal to liberalism or capitalism. And I would also say on the multi-agential approach, so here I'm just throwing out a hypothesis, but over the years it's come to seem to me more and more that feminist theory proposes a better explanation of the history that you have presented. For example, that Catherine MacKinnon uses the term masculinism, so I would use that term. Fascism and American working class ideology or immanent values and capitalism are closer together on the masculinist scale. And
wait, which two are closer together? I miss that.
Fascism. All of them. That's not just two. You got capitalism, you got working class, and I would add with working class now, working class and rural white America, their immanent values. And the way those intersect in terms of producing the imaginary in the United States, the reason they flip so easily into each other, or could flip easily into each other, is precisely on masculinism. In practical politics, this means obnoxious macho blowhard can win over people who have very different value systems.
should I, it seems like there's three different, yeah.
Why don't you deal with that? One other point just in terms of immanent values that I wonder about here is, so I just wonder what you think about this, but there are immanent values that come from people's like gut emotional responses.
Yeah.
And then there's what people say. There's discourse, there's theory, there's movies and pop culture. And so I'm wondering where you put the gut emotional side of it. All right, let's.
Well, there's a lot to go on, huh? These are great questions, by the way. So the first is that, of course, the standard social image of Marxism is that it's reductivist and determinist because it brings everything back to the economy. I would say two things about this. One is that what I'm really invested in is the most robust materialist analysis that we can provide, and that a multi-agential account which looks at agency that's not reducible just to individuals or to institutions or to economic forces, but takes into account the totality of different forms of agency, right? And I could go on at length about this, but this bottle has agency because it holds the water within it and doesn't allow it to spill all over the floor. And that I can't do. And so I have a very expansive understanding of agency, and I think that individuals are actually nodal points of conflicting agential forces. Freud, of course, developed this quite extensively. So on the one hand, I'm not interested in trying to like shoehorn a multi-agential account into some type of pre-established Marxist narrative about things. But the other thing that I would say is that if you do a deep materialist analysis of the Marxist tradition, then you need to admit that the image that we have, that's the standard image of Marxism being reductivist, determinist, etc., is about the most reductivist, determinist, simplistic narrative that one could ever imagine. Marx himself, of course, highlighted the limitations of the infrastructure-superstructure distinction. Engels, right after Marx's death, published a number of important texts where he insisted on this point. And the entire Marxian heritage, which is as complex, multi-layered and variegated as other traditions, such as the feminist traditions or anti-colonial traditions, people like Gramsci, like the entire Gramscian corpus, among other things, was trying to insist on the fact that economic determinism is not how we should understand Marxism. So I would couple that with my insistence on multidimensionality. Regarding capitalism and fascism, you said that they could be separate phenomena, and what I would say is that perhaps conceptually, but materially, they have not been. If we look at the history of fascism understood in its limited sense, as it's classically understood, emerging in Italy in the interwar period and with Nazism at the same point, it emerged in the economic crisis of the interwar period on the heels of the threat of the Russian Revolution and a need for the ruling class to reconsolidate its power in relationship to the possibility of a communist takeover. That immediate conjuncture leads to the idea that, well, fascism in the restricted sense is the police of capitalism. Now, in the restricted sense, if you actually expand that via Césaire and others, and you think of it historically, with the entire history of primitive accumulation, colonial endeavors, the prison industrial complex, the war economy, etc., then you have to recognize that, yes, brutal destruction of populations is one of the fundamental ways in which capitalism regulates the world. And that's why the good cop, bad cop metaphor, I think, functions really well, because they operate in tandem, right? It's not the real way that the good cop, bad cop operates is not that you're being interrogated by a police officer, beats the shit out of you, and then you finally admit something. The way that it operates is he beats the shit out of you, and then you say, can you let that good cop back in, and I'll just fucking sign the form and agree to whatever the hell you want, because I am tired of being pummeled. And what that is, the good cop, is liberal ideology. You're just going to sign up, like, okay, I'm a citizen, I'm going to stop protesting. And that tandem is a way of regulating different populations.
Yep. I think that works even if they are not closely connected. That is, you can have the barbarians at the gates, and I use that metaphorically. It can be whoever one calls the barbarians, whoever one calls the enemy, and say, look, if you don't go with me, if you don't go with absolute state, we're going to end up in the worst possible situation, right? And it doesn't have to be so closely internally linked. The other point So on the history, like, it seems to me, in the little history you gave of fascism, what I would say is you left out, what you explained was why the ruling classes, when faced with different options,
They used both all the time.
They decided to go, that fascism would work for them. They thought they could control Hitler in Germany and Mussolini in Italy, but the working class went with fascism for a totally different reason. And so it's interesting that you have these totally different worldviews that come together and form an alliance. And so this is also an issue, is that the question of how important are worldviews? So I think they are important. I would just maybe throw in a couple of complications. And one is trying to figure out why, I mean, so this has been a problem in political sociology and American sociology ever since I was in college. Why do the libertarians and the family values conservatives, like, why do they form an alliance? Because their political theories are, to the extent you can call them theories, but their political discourses, totally in conflict. And the other complication is, do you have a place for how systems keep going even if nobody believes in them? So that seems to me an important aspect.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot. Maybe one thing that would be helpful is that for the a full account of fascism, you need a detailed analysis of psychological warfare and how it operates. Because a unique thing about the way in which fascism developed in Europe, for instance, is that it was a ruling class project that was able to mobilize certain of the masses. Not the communists, there's a lot of people who are hostile to and rabidly opposed to fascism. And the way you do that is through psychological warfare, through massive propaganda operations. And what those propaganda operations do is they produce operative worldviews, such as the problem with the economic crisis is a whole series of scapegoats. If we get those scapegoats, if we destroy them, if we kill them, if we get them out, then that's going to solve our problems. And that's one of the ways in which you mobilize a certain mass support. But one of the things that's interesting historically is that that mass support is usually quite small because of the ways in which the ruling class also owns the military apparatus and the entire televisual apparatus. So in the case of the Trump phenomenon, one thing that very few people know is that in the primaries, he was polling at nothing. He was a non-phenomenon. In certain states, he was getting a few thousand votes. It was a total joke. What made him into a phenomenon was the way in which the primary system in the United States is absolutely rigged, combined with the entire propagandistic apparatus and how it used the buffoonery of a multimillionaire to promote him, give him basically free advertising, and create him as a phenomenon. And this is related to something that I'm very critical of, and that is fascism is almost systematically blamed. I mean, this is what the ruling class is really good at. There's a really cataclysmic social problem. Who do you want to blame it on? Have you seen this? There's this great meme where there's a bunch of really wealthy white guys hanging out in a room laughing their fucking asses off. And one of the people is saying, let's blame it on the poor. And that's what is systematically done. So the white working class, Adolf Reed has gone after this myth and destroyed it at the level of an analysis of the electoral results. What you do is you have the propaganda apparatus around a trust fund baby who's promoted by the most draconian of the corporate investors, and you blame that phenomenon on the white working class. Now, does that mean that no white working class people ever voted for Trump? No, of course not. Some of them did, and there's a psychological warfare mechanism that led them to vote for them. Who developed that psychological warfare mechanism and that propaganda? The ruling class did, right? And so we need a more complex understanding of how propaganda operates and how fascism is a multidimensional phenomenon, But it's a multidimensional phenomenon that has these kind of different layers to it.
It sounds too much like marionettes to me. Instead, I would say that here is where race comes in. That there was a common meeting point between the libertarians and
working
class and rural population in terms of racism. So critical race theory.
Racism plays, racism, misogyny, they play important roles, of course. The other thing to point out is that there's one candidate that has won every single American election since World War II. One candidate. Who's that candidate? Abstention. Every single election.
Right.
Of course, because of the way in which the political system is completely rigged, and there's the system, if it be anything from the primary system to the electoral system or to other such factors. And so the idea that you'd have this enormous body of the population that would just be like bloodthirsty racists, yeah, you have some. Yes, they are amply supported by the corporatocracy. Look at how the black shirts developed by Mussolini. One of the goals of the ruling class is to get poor people to beat up other poor people and to blame all social problems on poor people. And that orchestration is often one that if you don't understand how the larger mechanisms of the manipulation of minds works, then you can't see it. How often have you seen presidential results where they announce the abstention rate? You have to dig and dig and dig, usually, to be able to find it. Because nobody actually really believes in the sham of pseudo-representational democracy. A few people do, mainly they're liberals, and they're the people who go out and vote, and some conservatives who do it. And of course, the other thing that I would really insist in is, I mean, we're talking about really specific things like American electoral politics. If you're going to give a multidimensional analysis, you have to go through every different community, and you have to do a really detailed account. It can't simply be, oh, the white working class, or this, or that. And that's what a multi-agential account is. And I can't give that just kind of off the cuff. And I haven't done that work myself. But I've done enough of it to know that it's a much more complex phenomenon. The other point that you highlighted is immanent values and gut reactions. I think that the way social agents are constituted is that, and this overlaps with what I had referred to earlier as this compositional model of ideology, is that there are layers of our being that have been constituted that are actually part of our own personal amnesia. We don't even know they were put there. And that's arguably the majority of what constitutes us. There have been psychological studies that are great that highlight how often during the day do human beings think a thought that they haven't already thought. It's like, you know, fleeting second. The rest of the day, it's just this road. Oh, I'm anxious about this. Oh, I forgot to take my meds. Whatever else it might be. And the reason that I say that is that I think that gut reactions are a case in point, because gut reactions are often deeply historically constituted, but that historicity is rendered invisible. That historicity is rendered invisible because it's naturalized that someone have a gut reaction to a certain thing. And I think that emotions are operate in that way. Does it mean that other people might have similar gut reactions? Yeah, if they've been constituted in similar ways, for sure. But are there other questions, comments, profound criticisms? Maybe we'll start here and look around.
You were talking about the immanent value. I think I got a bit lost as to what exactly do you mean by the immanent here. And then there was this brief thing about the reality. You said that reality is not absolutely given. Does that mean that there is no absolute reality, or that there it is not absolutely given? Do you see the distinction?
Yeah.
The other thing was, and I was just curious about this, as to, you know, you said this unidimensional view of time or history or epochs. I wonder as to how was it historically for people, like if, because I think you seem to sort of suggest that it's sort of tied to you know, capitalism, or like the way we talk about times today, like zeitgeist and stuff. Has it always been like in history, were there people who would talk about their times, or was it something that, you know, this sort of a development is something that's recent? So, you know,
yeah.
These were the kinds of things that I was thinking.
Yeah. By immanent values, I simply mean the way in which particular communities forge a shared axiology. So they say things like, hey, life is better than death. Other communities might not do that, right? There's Bataille's famous analysis of Aztec culture in which the goal of a particular game was to win the game so that you'd be put to death and sacrificed to the gods. Right? So those values are immanently constituted, but that doesn't mean that they're somehow, like, their level of sedimentation can be absolutely profound. So it constitutes your gut feelings, it constitutes thinking, yeah, I'd rather have my loved ones live rather than die. So that's kind of what I mean by imminent values, but they continue to be negotiated. I think some are more negotiable than others, right? Life and death is kind of hard to negotiate. You'd be like, eh, same thing. It's pretty hard to commit suicide just kind of by accident, you know? Regarding reality, I think that reality is also, it's a imminently constituted. That doesn't mean that there aren't, like, the radical historicism for me is related to a historical ontology. And that is the result of certain scientific claims emerging out of the history of evolutionary biology. And so, for someone like me, Homo sapiens is a line that we've drawn in the sand. It's not a real line. That is the result of biological forces that have developed on planet Earth. And that, so the whole idea that reality would just be like something that I would make up in my mind, or reality would just be something out there in the world, I think are both misguided ideas, if that makes sense. And then I'm trying to go quickly just because I saw a lot of hands, but the Zeitgeist question, I think one of the most interesting things about the history of temporality, even the recent history of temporality, is that revolutionary time, almost everybody agrees on this, was largely invented at the end of the 18th century. You move from what different theorists have called a cyclical conception of temporality, in which social structures repeat themselves like the seasons would repeat themselves, to an understanding of temporality in which you have a future horizon that emerges as a field of possibility that can have a utopian projection onto it and that can radically break with everything we've seen before. Right? The work of Reinhard Kozelek, the work of François Hartog, there's a number of other people who have worked on this front, which also reveals the extent to which temporality is profoundly political because it situates us in time and says, hey, this is what we can do and this is what we can't do. And of course, there's a lot of great work today on the presentism of consumer capitalism, right? Where, particularly in the United States, nobody knows anything about history, like literally zilch. And so history has just disappeared in the name of the present. And then the future, well, at best, what do we have in the future? Well, repetition of the same that we have in the present, because we have no revolutionary horizon that would bring in some absolutely new future in which there'd be a new, like the new man or new configurations of social relations and things like this. I'd highly recommend The Modern Concept of Revolution by Reinhard Kozelek, which is in Futures Past. But there's an enormous body of really good literature on this. Maybe working around, I think Romel in the back, and then Leo.
Okay, so you mentioned about the aesthetics of politics.
Yeah.
And I wonder if you can say a bit more, how exactly do these two things relate to one another? Does aesthetic have its autonomy from the political, or is just another way of doing the political? Because and another point is what role does the scholarly community, particularly the instrumentalized intellectuals within the community, in aestheticizing politics? Because I was thinking that perhaps from the standpoint of the common people, what we regard as politics, they don't see it as politics. Because if they do, they might not believe in it. But they by thinking differently, so they believe that Trump, for example, resonates with them. So in my sense, perhaps from the common people's standpoint, they are seeing things differently from the way we call political. It probably it's the aesthetic, the feeling, that kind of connection. And what role does the scholarly community in general have in aestheticizing the political?
Yeah, that's a great question. I would say a few things. One is that, and I really developed this argument in detail in my book, Radical History and the Politics of Art, I argued against any essentializing definition of art and politics or any transcendent account thereof. Instead, in favor of recognizing that they are historically constituted social signifiers that remain in struggle, even though they've sedimented in various ways. And so the sedimented conception of art that we have is largely the result of developments since the end of the 18th century and the kind of exhibitionary colonial framework for what art is as this separate thing that individuals would make and then they would present it to a public and it would become maybe a saleable object or something to indulge in with the bourgeois gaze. And what politics is a set of state institutions that's protecting the citizenry from the savagery of itself or something along these lines. If we recognize, though, that politics and aesthetics are not simply these kind of reified entities, but they've been constituted in that way, what that does is reveal the extent to which operative understanding, so the dominant hegemonic understanding of art, like the hegemonic understanding of politics, what they often do is occlude or foreclose broader understandings of what both of these practices are. So a lot of my project in aesthetics is invested in showing how art in the singular, art that we see in museums, etc., is communicating to the masses that the creative power of producing something new, interesting, exciting, etc., is only the privilege of a very few group of people who operate within a particular exchange value understanding of what art is. So it deflates, or it takes the world-making capacity of aesthetics writ large and reduces it to art and its exchange value. Right? So my understanding of aesthetics is more in this, the capacious ability of world-making in all senses, right? Of making values, of forging subjects, of making ways of seeing, etc. And so, and the same goes for politics, because politics is really reduced to the state mechanism, so that a lot of people will say, oh, what about Trump or somebody getting elected? What about real politics, like how people organize their communities? There's enormous modes of mobilization and movements that are going on that people don't even recognize as existing, because they're so fixated on the next election, which is, of course, the spectacle of, you know, politics in its liberal pageantry. So what I mean by the aesthetics of power is how a particular power mechanism has the power to produce its own images, and that the image of itself is a quintessential aspect to its power. The best example of this is U.S. imperialism since World War II. The U.S. has overthrown some 30, minimum 30, foreign governments. It's between 30 and 50. I can't remember off the top of my head. Anyway, it's a large number. And almost all of them democratically elected, has performed targeted assassinations against, 20 to 30 foreign leaders, minimum, bare minimum. And it's done all of this while producing all these Hollywood images about the U.S. fighting Nazism and being the good guy and things like this, which shows that the power needs that aesthetics. You can't have American imperialism of the extent that we have had, which has been absolutely brutal. I mean, the U.S. has been behind the globalization of the gulags. Like, they've been behind almost all of the fascistic and dictatorial regimes in the entire world. Suharto regime in Latin America, you've got Iran, you've got Suharto regime in Indonesia, you've got the majority of Latin America, you've got everything that they did in Africa. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. If everybody knew that, they would have a lot of trouble maintaining liberal hegemonic rule. So the aesthetics of power is how power produces an image of itself that allows it to exercise its power that much more ferociously. The question that you asked, the follow-up question that I'm going to answer slightly differently, just because the terminology that I was using is aesthetics of power, not politics, but I do think that it's important then to recognize the inverse of that would be the power of aesthetics. And the power of aesthetics consists in piercing that veil that has been produced through psychological warfare and doing at least two things. One is revealing what has actually gone on in the history of American imperialism, but in doing that, you not only reveal the kind of wizard in the machine, so to speak, but you also produce a different understanding of what politics and power can be. Because what most liberal nation states that are capitalists want to convince us of is that they do politics, not us. Right? That's their quintessential goal, is to convince all of us that politics is something we watch on TV. So the power of aesthetics is also the power of recalibrating our vision of the world so that we see things like co-ops, alternative anarchist spaces, communist organizations, radical education platforms, alternative press venues, indigenous land grabs, on and on and on. You see all of that as the politics of a collectivity that is saying, the image of politics that you've given to us, we're rejecting in both forms, both the lie of the image that you've given us and the lie that you're telling us that we don't own politics, you do. Alejo, I think you were...
So I have sort of two related questions. One is more specific, one is more general, maybe. One is, so you were kind of differentiating kind of history from, you know, like Foucault and Francière, and Derrida to a certain extent. But it sounds like this kind of multi-agential, I mean, like when you were explaining the multi-agential and when I was reading through the interview with Jennifer and some of the other stuff you've written, it sounds a lot like kind of Althusserian conception. Contemporality that a lot of people are working through today. So you have this kind of complex totality in which you have multiple layers of the social totality, politics, economics, art, and so on and so forth. And the now, as such, is not a now that is present to itself. It's a kind of, let's say, a non-contemporaneous now, right? There's no contemporaneity between different levels, between. So you can't talk about an epoch as such, right? So this is what Althusser talks about Marxist conception of history, historicity is, in which the now is not a now as such, in which there is an essence to it, right?
Right.
So that's what how he wants to read Marx in 62, whatever,
yeah.
65.
65, yeah.
And so it sounds very similar to kind of what you're saying, you know, in the sense that there's a sense of a totality, that's like a complex totality, it's overdetermined, and so on and so forth. And so I wonder if you could sort of say a little bit more about how is it different from the Althusserian conception of political temporality and complex whole. And then the other question is more in relation to some of the questions also that we've been sort of touching over. We've been kind of going quickly through things like history and time and, you know, sort of lived time. Now, whether you make a distinction between history, time, you know, there's also the narration of time, the narration of history. We've been talking about all these as if they were the same. And I wonder if you think that's an important distinction to make, if not, why or why not, you know.
Yeah.
Cosmology in the physical sense also has its own time.
Yeah.
So I wonder if, I wonder if you make a distinction or not.
Yeah, that's super helpful. I would say just on the Althusserian point, I think that there is a lot of overlap with the more multidimensional conception of temporality, the ways in which economics plays an important role, but for Althusser, like for Engels that he's drawing on, if economics is a determinant, it's a determinant in the last instant, and that does not mean that it's this kind of structural base that is always and everywhere the same, etc. At that level, there's a lot of similarity and overlap. It's true that I wasn't, at least in the work that I've done on historiography, actually drawing that explicitly on Althusser, but as soon as you said that, of course, it like resonates and is a similar conceptualization. He does have, in certain of his writings, he nonetheless has these kind of epical formulations that he has, particularly in the history of philosophy, that I find highly problematic. And at the level of geography and sociality, I also think there are a lot of problems that Althusser hasn't solved. So I'd want to add those two dimensions and really develop and have made these arguments for more complex understandings of geography and sociality. But I absolutely agree with the homology that you've identified. Regarding the second question, I think that there are a number of important distinctions that people have made. I'm more invested in... Bonjour. Vous fermez à 19h?
Oui, on met sous alarme à 19h.
Ah, carrément, ok, ça a changé cette semaine alors.
Le temps que les gens partent et tout.
Ah, ok, on va pas tarder. Ok. So new building law that they close at 7 sharp. So we gotta like all be folded up and out of here. So we're gonna wrap up really shortly. I am invested in this... terminology means different things to different people because there are a number of different debates on them, but the work that I've been doing on historical ontology is invested in a deep understanding of historicity that breaks with the anthropocentric timescale that tends to dominate both the way in which most people think about history and the way in which people think about personal time. And so I'm not particularly hung up on exactly what term will be used, but I am very invested in delinking from or breaking with the idea that history is simply the history of what Homo sapiens have done. It's a very impoverished and parochial understanding of what history is, or that time would just be about my own personal phenomenological experience of temporality. And so if you open up the infinite time scale, as has been done since historical geology, Lauren Isley's work is excellent on this in the 18th century, then you have a very different perspective in which the very constitution of an entity called Homo sapiens or planet Earth or in particular galaxies would be historical through and through. And so a historical ontology then radically historicizes all of our ontological categories, to be, you know, different types of beings. And that, I think, does allow us a very different perspective than the ways in which, because usually history and time are so, it's anthropocentric. It's so linked, at least in many debates, not all, but in many debates it's very linked to the anthropocentric timescale. So I think there's maybe one more question, or two more questions, maybe formulate them both together. I'll try to give a quick response and we'll wrap up in 5 to 10. Yeah, Ini?
So I was classified into the group Transforming Aesthetics and Transforming Politics, and so on Wednesday in our working groups we talked a lot about what transformation means. So I wanted to ask you, I want to push, as much as Ronser often tells us to like resist pre-designated categories that are imposed on us, I wanted to take this classification seriously to push you on the implications of this, your research for actually transforming politics. So you say that you're offering a robust materialist account of the history of our ideas and values, and you show how ideas are not abstract things floating in the air, but that they're created and sedimented through institutions like the CIA and the Congress for Cultural Freedom. And I think that's really, really persuasive. And as you said, what this shows is that the reality that we have is not an inevitable one, and that there is a possibility of the otherwise. So my question is, is it enough to show that something is a historical condition? When you show that something is a historical condition, is it sufficient for opening up a possibility for the otherwise? Because I don't think showing necessarily leads to the actual creation of alternative institutions, or it doesn't offer an alternative idea of what could be. And so my question really gets at the role of intellectuals here, and I think to believe in the power of critiquing concepts that organize our social life rest on certain presuppositions about how the role that ideas play in our society. And I think it has a role. Sometimes I doubt myself, but I do, and I want to point to a passage from a pragmatist, William James. So I want to bring your attention to this quote because I want to push you to ask whether you agree with this characterization of the relationship between concepts and reality, or whether you think differently. So the quote is this. This is from William James's Pragmatism Lectures, and it's one of my favorite quotes for all the time. So he says, "We plunge forward into the field of fresh experience with beliefs and concepts that our ancestors have made already. These concepts determine what we notice. What we notice determines what we do. And what we do again determines what we experience. So from one thing to another, the stubborn fact remains that there's a sensible flux. What is true of it seems first to last to be largely a matter of our own creation." So I take William James to be arguing that we may inherit concepts and values and ideas from our ancestors, and they shape what we can see. But as we act in the real world, there are different encounters that reshape the concepts that we have, and it's a continuous flux that ultimately allows us to shape reality in a different way. And so I'm wondering, when you say that critiquing current institutions has a powerful transformative effects, do you make assumptions of this kind, or do you believe that we need to make an extra effort to create institutions after this kind of historical critique?
That's fantastic. Great. Nate, you want to?
My question is just like, when you're talking about the powerful system that produces image, and I was thinking about COINTELPRO, the program, and because it was like capitalism gonna kill all like people who has like specific like radical ideas, and they kill the Black Panther Party's leaders and also Black Lives Matter's leaders, and
they didn't kill Black Lives Matter.
Martin Luther King, like he,
yeah, it wasn't a COINTELPRO operation, but it was a state operation.
Okay.
That has been, yeah.
Okay, and like, they are afraid of like the small group like feminism and this kind of LGBTQ, these kind of people become a like bigger power, and they kill some leaders of this kind of group.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking like if that is kind of like when they kill these kind of like leaders who have like radical thoughts and leave the group, and then it makes that as kind of idea and make the problem become like more like superficial concept, like they make like Black Panther as just a concept, and then the people doesn't have the thoughts to really to fight for themselves,
right?
And they divide like different groups like feminism and LGBTQ people as different groups, but they don't have like real radical thoughts to fight for themselves, so
right.
Is that how they work?
Yeah, that's a great, they're all great questions. I'm gonna try to do this in 5 minutes. So I absolutely agree with the point that you raised, that for me, intellectual labor and my own theoretical practice seeks to both map and intervene. And mapping is a materialist process by which you give the best possible account of a particular force field of relations regarding how certain values are produced, or a certain, in this case, the apparatus of knowledge that we've inherited. But doing that and pointing those things out, I agree, is insufficient. It's not like you can say, just demonstrate something, and then that automatically changes it. That's a kind of visibility fallacy. It's the idea that, well, if people just see it, it's going to change it. And we know that people see things all the time. It doesn't change things. And so mapping allows for an account to be given that also permits us to identify what I think are the best ways of intervening. By intervening, I mean the hard labor of producing the types of things that you're referring to, counter-institutions, political organizations, modes of collective interaction, autonomous intellectual production, etc., that aren't simply the pointing out how bad the system is, but are making, at whatever level they can, a new and different system. And I would say that a lot of my intellectual energy goes into precisely that. I'm involved in a ton of collaborative endeavors. I do a lot of things anonymously. I write in a number of different collectives. I've been involved in a number of different political organizations, founded a number of different political institutions, and it's precisely for that reason.
Two separate things, though. The critique of our history as contingent, and your involvement in different actions.
I don't see them as separate insofar as they inform one another at really profound levels. Like, any map that you develop is itself an intervention, because it's saying, hey, this is real. The CIA worked with hundreds of or thousands of academics. This is real. And producing that map is also producing different ways of intervening. So I don't see them. I see them as actually the richest way of doing intellectual work is by having your work be part of a broader community and ultimately political movements that are trying to move the world in particular ways.
Can I ask you one?
Yeah.
So I'm thinking, so I don't think they're separate either, but they're together in me. But I'm thinking of what the transformative effects of the historical work that you do on other people. Because the historical work that you do to you tells you that there is an alternative that can be created, and that incentivizes you to do all this other work. But is showing otherwise, is that going to have an effect on the people who read your work?
It's obviously impossible to determine exactly what effects certain work will have. I mean, I do know in the history of revelations around CIA, there's been a whole series of important publications that did have major impacts. Did they abolish the CIA? No. You know, there. I think that the broadest impact is also that if your work is invested in a particular movement, then the questions that you're asking, the way you relate to your work, is also in relationship to what it does with, for that movement. And so I don't see them as disarticulated, if you will. And then just quickly to wrap up on, I hope everybody knows about COINTELPRO. It's a great example of the extent to which the US is not a liberal democracy. It has a fascistic rule of any communities that oppose it. So they killed 29 members of the Black Panthers, 69 members of the American Indian Movement, and it was a brutal repressive force that also, well, it did a lot of other things. So I think that one of the things that COINTELPRO really illustrates is that the goal of the FBI was run by COINTELPRO and the CIA, and they work hand in glove, because the real goal was to kill an idea. And that idea is that human beings can collectively forge a new reality in which socioeconomic equality, or at least relative equality, would be part of the agenda. And that in killing and incarcerating the leaders of those movements, that was the goal. You wanted to kill the very possibility of that. And when you look at what happened in activist and organizing communities in the United States post-60s and 70s, a lot of it, you see a kind of return to a liberal, left, multicultural, reformist politics that is not the radical politics of the American Indian Movement, of the Black Panthers, and of many other movements of that time. So I think the impact was massive. It was really massive. But, and this is the last thing that I'll say, the reason that they had to intervene so forcefully is because the imperial hegemon was on its heels and they were scared shitless. And you see this throughout all the documents, because America was on fire and they were really, really threatened by that. And that's when the fascism and the authoritarian comes out. So we also can't just read it, I think, in a negative sense, saying that, well, when we really try to change things, it's going to kill us. You got to know that. But you also have to recognize that, well, they did that because they were scared. They were very scared by a whole series of radical movements in the 60s and 70s. But we got to wrap up and get out of the building quickly so we can continue chatting if you want tonight or outside.